So we are discussing now spin models in connection to quantum computation, and I told you that there are various aspects of these spin models in the context of quantum computation. First, material science, then there is also some viewpoint from the side of the optimization. So in many optimization problems, there appears a problem of minimization of a function of many variables, and this function has a lot of minima. And actually, the problem can be very severe to find the lowest minima, actually, the global minima of this function. And in particular, this problem appears in optimization, like traveling salesman problem. So imagine that there is some person who sells something and he has to visit various places, and there are multiple choices how he can do this. And actually, so there are, if you try to minimize in some parameter space, if you try to find a global minimum, you will see that there are a lot of local minima. It is very difficult to find the global one. So imagine that you come to Moscow and you want to go to Chernogolovka and to Troitsk, to Kapitsa Institute, and then you are stocked, you are in trouble. Indeed, there are many different options how you can do this. And actually, it turns out that similar problems which appear in the minimization, they appear also in the field of spin models, and actually in particular in the field of spin glasses. So imagine that you have Ising model with the long range interaction now, not with interaction between only nearest neighbors, but all spins can interact with each other, and there are interaction constants which are not actually the same for all these pairs of sides. And then it turns out that there are indeed a lot of local minima, and it can be shown rigorously that this problem can be reduced to the solution to the optimization problems like traveling salesman problem. So they are to a certain extent equivalent. And then people try to map the optimization problems to the problem of spin glasses, and to find from physically meaningful considerations to try to find global minima corresponding to the particular spin glass model. Okay. However, there is a general problem that if you try to find global minimum of this spin model classically, you will be trapped in local minima. And this is a very severe problem, so you don't know how to find it. And the general idea is that quantum resources and quantum parallelism can help to get to the local minima. This is the idea of quantum annealing. But first of all, I would like to... So parallelism is not always good. Sometimes it is good, sometimes it is not. So this is kind of a joke. So if you try to give all parallel answers to your teacher, for instance, you can be in trouble. But sometimes it can help, and I will show you how. Okay. So when you have reduced this problem to the optimization problem to the physical problem, you can have different strategies. The first strategy is the naive approach. So you can use something like a gradient descent. So you try to first put to your numerics some initial guess, then you change this initial guess, and you always go along the trajectories with decreasing energy or decreasing cost function. However, in this case, you frequently trapped in local minima. And then you have to change the initial state, and you must compare this local minima between each other. And this is very costly from the viewpoint of computations, because the number of this local minimum can grow exponentially. Less naive approach is a simulated annealing. And it was proposed like something like 30 years ago. The idea was taken from metallurgy, actually, and from the industry. They use this simulated annealing to decrease the number of defects in crystal lattices. So the idea is that first you heat your system and it becomes melt, and then you adiabatically cool it down. And if you do it really adiabatically, then you can get to the local, to the global minimum, which corresponds to the pure lattice without any defects. And the same is applied here. But there is a bottleneck here that you have to do it really adiabatically. And once you have local minima, which are very much separated in the energy space from each other, you can again be trapped there. And another approach which is less naive, but maybe it is also naive, I don't know, this is quantum annealing. And here you use the resource of quantum tunneling. So few words about simulated annealing. Here the idea is that instead of sampling of all local minima, we allow for trajectories which locally can increase energy. So you can escape, for instance, you are in this trap, but once you allow for trajectories which can help you, which can increase energy, you can get here, and then you can eventually go to the global minimum of your system. The idea is smart, but it doesn't work if you have high barriers, because the probability to overcome this barrier is proportional to the exponential minus the height of the barrier divided by kt. And depending on the barrier, on its characteristics, maybe you have a choice between simulated annealing and quantum annealing. In some cases, quantum annealing can be, in principle, more powerful than simulated annealing. Okay, and quantum annealing, the idea is very simple in some sense, because instead of temperature, you have here quantum fluctuations and quantum tunneling, and you can circumvent this barrier by tunneling through it. And in this case, barrier height is not so important, because the probability to tunnel, it is described, it is determined by the some combination of barrier height and barrier width. And for instance, if you go to the dissipative limit, if there is some microscopic system which tries to tunnel out of this trap through some barrier, and it is connected to the bath of some environment, okay, this is can be described by the famous Leggett-Caldera model for macroscopic quantum tunneling, then it can be shown that in this case the probability to tunnel is proportional to the not the height but the width of the barrier. So apparently if your barrier is very high and very thin, then it is more profitable to tunnel, to apply quantum annealing, compared to the simulated annealing. And this is actually the idea which is used in quantum annealing devices. I'm not going to talk more many things about quantum annealing, just few ideas. And the idea is generally like this. So you have to create a system, this is an analog simulation, which is one-to-one mapped into a desired Hamiltonian. And then you somehow let this system to evolve. Nature, instead of you, makes all the computations using this quantum tunneling resources in some sense. And finally, you make measurements and you determine what is the final, what the final state is. And this is what's implemented in superconducting quantum circuits. All of you probably know about D-wave machines. This is one of the examples. And precisely the protocol is like this. So initially you have a classical Ising model described by these two terms. So you have Z-Z interaction and external field which points in the Z direction. But also you add a time-dependent field which points in the X direction. So if you take this piece and this piece, this is a kind of a transverse field Ising model. But now you have also a term from the Z direction. And what you do is that initially you have only these quantum terms, quantum in the sense that they produce superposition of qubits, and you turn off Ising term. And you initially you have all the qubits in the superposition states, as dictated by this term, by this term which tries to push them in this superposition. Then you gradually decrease the weight of this term and increase the weight of this term. And if you evolve adiabatically the system, if you do it very slowly in time, then from the ground state of this system, you should go to the ground state of the Ising system, Ising Hamiltonian. And finally, you can measure the populations of upper levels of all qubits or whatever you want, so you can determine the configuration which is supposed to be ground state configuration. This is called adiabatic quantum computer or quantum simulator based on the protocol of quantum annealing. You cannot run this protocol using this IBM quantum experience because IBM quantum experience actually is a universal quantum computer which is based on discrete operations. Here this is an analog stuff, okay, but anyway you can try to simulate this quantum annealing using this machine. I will show you probably at the end of this day some results obtained by John Martinez, where he tried to simulate this quantum annealing using universal quantum computer based on discrete operations. Okay, finally there is also quantum computation side of the spin models and their relevance for quantum computation. As I already mentioned, spin models are very good from the viewpoint of quantum computing because you can directly map degrees of freedom of spin system and qubits of the chip, because qubits in some sense are artificial macroscopic spins and their statistics is the same as the statistics of spin systems. There is no problem with quantum statistics like in the case when you try to simulate fermions using qubits. There is a severe problem related to the fact that you try to push enforce unnatural statistics for your system. There is an anti-symmetrization property for fermions, and here you don't have it. And actually, this is the consequence of the fact that qubits or different spins, they don't feel each other on the level of statistics. If you don't have any interaction with your system, it doesn't matter how you create your state. You can do this, or you can do this, and it will be the same, okay? While for fermions this is not true. Okay, so it is natural in this for these reasons to start the discussion of many body systems from spin systems. And first of all, I would like, in addition to these operators X and Y, Pauli operators, I would like to introduce rising and lowering Pauli operators. Actually, I have already introduced them here. So they can be defined in this way through Pauli operators. And these operators, they create an annihilate excitation of qubits. They excite or de-excite upper levels. In the matrix form, sigma plus reads as like this. And sigma minus is like this. So if you act by sigma plus on zero, you create one. If you add by sigma plus on one, you create nothing, null. If you act by sigma minus on one, you de-excite your qubit. And if you act on zero, you get null. And in some sense, these operators are similar to fermion creation and annihilation operators. If you, for instance, have some basis, some single particle basis, you can introduce fermion operators associated with the creation or annihilation of one particle states in this basis. And you can think that this rising and lowering Pauli operators are similar to them. Unfortunately, this is not, maybe fortunately, this is not true, because these fermion operators, they have the property of anti-symmetry property. This is the kind of a summary of this discussion. So you can introduce commutations relations for these Pauli operators at different sites on the same sign. There is a property of the anti-commutation on the same site. Okay, so if you take the same site, you have anti-commutation. Like for the fermion, you have one, and this reflects the fact that there is no more than single excitation at each site. But there is another property which makes qubits and spins very different from fermions, is that qubits are independent. And if you consider commutators of operators at different sites, you get zero. While for fermions, you should have anti-commutation relations, the same, but anti-commutation relations zero. And this is very important. So as I told you already, you can try to simulate these spin systems using two different approaches. First one, this analog simulation. This is like simulated annealing, the quantum annealing, adiabatical protocols. And here there should be one-to-one correspondence between the model system and simulators. So this kind of simulators, they are suitable for a single problem or a narrow class of problems, like finding the Ising state. Here, this is the D-wave machine, and you see the layout of the qubit chip, which is used to simulate Ising model. It is quite complicated. It consists of eight individual chips, which includes eight qubits, and they are interconnected in a very complicated form. So it is very difficult also to map all this mess to Ising model. But nevertheless, they try to do it. And D-wave machine is now can be you can buy them actually. And this is the slide from the presentation of Alexey Ustinov. So there is a nice title here that this machine, it promises to solve some of humanity's most complex problems. It is backed by Jeff Bezos, NASA, and the CIA. Each one costs $10 million and operates at some incredible temperature below zero, and nobody knows how it actually works, and if it works or if it doesn't work at all. But anyway, you can buy it. So different American corporations, they have already bought several of these machines, and they do different exercises with them. And many people from the scientific community, they are quite skeptical with respect to the abilities of these machines. But nevertheless, from time to time, D-Wave publish papers in very high-level journals. And recently, for instance, there was a paper in Nature just a few days ago. They managed to observe some topological phenomena in the chip of almost 10,000 qubits. So the idea here is that they had some vortices and anti-vortices, and they attributed this to some topological quantum phenomena. And okay, so what I don't know whether this is indeed true or not. So it is closely related to the work of Berzinsky, Kosterlitz, and Taulis, and they have constructed some kinds of the phase diagram. They simulated Ising model in a transverse field. So here there is a temperature, and here is the ratio of two coefficients in this which appear in this protocol of quantum annealing. So the ratio of two constants which are responsible for the quantum term and for the classical term. As in the low temperature regime, you have the ordered phase, in the Kosterlitz-Taulitz phase, where you have a proliferation of topological defects, and they, according to their estimates, they manage to pass through this phase along this line, okay, and to reconstruct something very nice, which they attribute to quantum effects, but in reality it might be not quantum defects because topological defects, vortices and anti-vortices, they also appear in purely classical models, so maybe it is not really the case. But anyway, they publish such papers. And in addition, another story, a few years ago they have published a paper where they demonstrated a quantum speed up for finding the ground state of the Ising model, but the landscape of the model was on purpose constructed in such a way that the barriers were very high and very thin. And for such an artificial landscape, they indeed managed to find some quantum speed up. At least it is believed that this was the case. And at least for such artificial and strange profiles, the idea can work. Okay, so another approach to the simulation of spin systems is associated with the algorithmic quantum computer, along the ideas I have shown you before. So you use a set of discrete operations, and here the same processor can be used to realize many different algorithms in contrast to analog simulators. So you can execute algorithms which are related to quantum modeling, and you can actually model different systems using the same chip, and you can run different other algorithms as well. And what is nice is that now you have, we have already devices which contain up to 72 qubits or 50 qubits in the case of IBM. And non-trivial physics in some sense begins with tens of qubits, because if you take 2^50, this number is already too large for best modern supercomputers to operate and to work with. So if you have the system with, say, 60 spins, you cannot simulate it from first principles using best classical supercomputers. So the question is, are we close to some practical impact or no? And already thousands of operations can be made within the coherence time. Well, in my point of view, the answer is that it is not evident, because still there are a lot of problems, as I already mentioned. The problem of decoherence and gate errors, mainly 2-qubit gates. So possible solutions is to implement error correction codes. However, this is associated with the enormous overhead of resources, of quantum resources. And people now try to circumvent these difficulties by suggesting new ideas on hybrid quantum classical calculations with relatively shallow quantum algorithms, quantum circuits. So the part of the work is done by the quantum computing device, and the part is done by classical computer. And also they try to mitigate errors or partially correct them. So the hope, or maybe a dream, that some heuristic combination of these ideas could lead to the quantum supremacy in the near term future. Okay, so there are some examples of new ideas, and I will cover some of them. Okay, now I turn to the algorithmic simulation. And this is again time to concentrate. Actually, up to now, there were two main approaches to simulate quantum systems using algorithmic quantum computer. First one is the simulation of the unitary evolution, and another one is the variational method. So the simulation of the unitary evolution is, in some sense, a first principle solution of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation on chip. So you create some, the idea is very simple, is that you create some initial state on your chip, initial state of the qubits, then you, in some sense, mimic the action of the evolution operator within your chip. So you mimic it by applying these 1-qubit gates and 2-qubit gates. And at the end, you perform measurements and you extract information about the time-dependent dynamics of your model. So it's a kind of a discretized quantum mechanical solution of your problem on the chip. So there are advantages and disadvantages of this approach. And advantage is that there is a good scaling in terms of precision. So in principle, you can find any quantity with any desired accuracy. The price for that is that you have to apply very long algorithms, and this leads to the disadvantage. So you have to implement long circuits, and this implies that your quantum computer must be close to the ideal in order to get some practically relevant results, because there should be essentially no decoherence, no gate errors, no readout errors. Okay. Another approach is based on a variational method. So the idea again that you create, this is a kind of a hybrid quantum classical computation. Initially, you create some initial guess variational trial state on your chip, which is parameterized by a set of parameters. And then you, in some sense, measure the expectation value of your Hamiltonian operator on the chip. You evaluate the estimate for the ground state, and then your classical computer changes the input parameters of your trial function, and you proceed through a loop. Okay, now I'm going to give quite long introduction to the first method, the unitary evolution, to the method of unitary evolution, using some examples from our practice, from our papers on quantum computation with IBM quantum computers. But the idea is not our. The idea is known, actually. So the unitary evolution, the general scheme, it consists of several parameters. First, you have to represent your Hamiltonian through spin variables and to establish a correspondence between the initial model you want to, initial spin system you want to model, and your chip, taking into account the real limitations of the topology. And since we are working for the moment with spin models, then there is no problem of this fermionic problem, no problem of anti-symmetrization, and first line is absent in some sense. Okay, but anyway, you have to be careful with the correspondence between the degrees of freedom of a model systems and qubits of the chip. So the topology of the chip matters in the sense that, first of all, of course, you have some limitations which arise from the number of qubits available on the chip, but also you have also limitations from the available CNODs which you can apply on your chip. And CNODs are needed to simulate the dynamics and to create initial states on your system. So this is a quite important point to, from the very beginning, to make a clear choice for the topology, for the association between these initial spins and the qubits. So if we take into account this chip, okay, of IBM, we can immediately see that it is suitable for the simulation of the central spin model, because the topology of this chip exactly matches the topology of the central spin model. I will tell you more about this model. So this model is something like that. Ah, no, just a second, later. Now about 16 qubit device. So it is very suitable for the simulation of spin ladders and spin chains, or maybe one-dimensional Hubbard model. I will tell you more later. So each qubit can be associated with the spin, and you can, using these CNOT gates, you can produce digitally interaction between these two neighboring qubits. So you can simulate Heisenberg or Ising model in this device. And this 20 qubit IBM device, it is quite good for simulation of quite complicated 2D spin models, including Heisenberg and Ising models. Okay, so I'm going to show you some of our recent results related to simulation of spin models, and I start with the simplest central spin model and 5-qubit chip. So the central spin model, it is quite popular in the field of quantum dots, and it can be used to describe the decoherence of this associated with the coupling of the quantum dot with the external degrees of freedom. So there is some central particle with spin 1/2. Okay, so it can be in two states. And it is surrounded in some sense by the cloud or the bath of non-interacting particles, spin 1/2 particles. And the Hamiltonian of this model reads like this. So you have spin, central spin, Hamiltonian non-interacting. So C means central. And you have the energy cost epsilon C associated, which you need to pay to excite this central spin. You have the same terms for the bath of for each particle of the bath, okay, with their own energies, and you have an interaction between the central particle and the particles of the bath, and this interaction is very simple. So in some sense, you either excite the particle of the bath, like here, and you de-excite your central particle. Or vice versa, you excite your central particle and you de-excite particle of this of the bath. And summation here is over all spins of the bath. Okay, and this model it can be seen that it conserves the excitation number, so the number of excited particles in the system. So you either excite and you have to de-excite. So if you fix the excitation number, if your initial state, for instance, contained only single excitation, and you consider a free evolution, then single excitation state must be at the end. Okay, so you see that this topology can be very nicely associated with the topology of this chip. So you can associate this, for instance, this central qubit with the central particle of this model, and here particles of the bath, of the quantum bath. And this CNODs, it can be used first to create initial states on your system which can be entangled. And second, they will be used to mimic the action of the evolution operator with this Hamiltonian, how it influences the initial state encoded into this chip. Okay? So first, okay, so maybe I will save time. Okay, so if you consider full resonance, full resonance means that all these spin 1/2 particles have the same excitation energies, then you can drop the first term and you are left only with this term which describes the interaction between the central particle and the particles of the bath. So you have only this term in the Hamiltonian. Now if you try to rewrite these Hamiltonian terms of usual X and Y Pauli matrices, you will see that this term, okay, it also quite nicely and symmetrically reduces to the XX and YY interaction. So the final Hamiltonian we are going to work is like this. And this is the Hamiltonian of the central spin model. And the resonance, there is another physical realization which leads to the same Hamiltonian. This is a Dickey Hamiltonian, which is known from quantum optics. And it describes a set of two-level systems interacting with the photon mode. So if you are in the resonance and you adopt a rotating wave approximation, and you consider the sector with only single excitation, there is an exact mapping to the central spin model. So this central spin model, it appears in various contexts, in various limiting cases. Okay, so now, so we are understood more or less how to map the initial state, the initial system we want to model, the central spin model, to the chip, to the 5-qubit chip, taking into account limitations of the topology. The next step is that we must prepare some initial step in the real quantum device, and we want to study the evolution, the free evolution of our system starting from this initial state. So we are moving to this second stage, preparation of the initial state in the quantum device. I will consider several examples. For instance, we want to create such a state, initial state of the system in tangled bath. So the state is that central particle is not excited, it is in a ground state, and you have also particles of the bath which are entangled, and the entanglement is that is tricky. So you have some tunable phase parameter which you can plug into your wave function from the very beginning. So the dynamics must be dependent on this phi, on this phase parameter. What is nice is that this is a Bell state, and if it is entangled, then we should see in the discretized dynamics the consequences of this entanglement and consequences of the quantum interference effects which must appear in the dynamics. In particular, if phi is equal to pi, then the state of the bath is antisymmetric Bell state psi minus, okay, like this. And this state actually is nothing but the eigenstate of the initial Hamiltonian, of the central spin Hamiltonian. So if we take into account initial state, the full initial state of the system like this, and the central qubit particle unexcited, then if we apply H to this state, our Hamiltonian operator, then we get zero, because here we have minus sign, and H is constructed in such a way that it either creates excited state of this qubit, and the price is that you de-excite one of the qubits of the bath. So you de-excite both qubits, you create an excited state, and here you have cancellation of these two terms. And this means that if phi is equal to pi, this state must be the eigenstate of your system. But for instance, if you tune out of this pi, then the state is no longer the eigenstate of the system, and we should see the consequences of this behavior in our dynamics. Here is the demonstration that this is, that I am not lying, and if phi is equal to pi, then by H on this initial state, you have term of this kind. So when phi is pi, you have disappearance of this term. And this is also quite nice from the point of view of physics, of qualitative understanding in some sense, because you have here a cancellation of two terms which come from two different spins. And so they must meet in some sense in the correct time, in the right place, to kill each other and to give zero at the end. So when phi is equal to pi, there should be no central spin dynamics, and if you use the language of quantum optics, this is the dark state known from quantum optics. And in some sense, this is also the excitation blockade. So if you create an excitation in your bath, but your bath is entangled, then this excitation, despite of the fact that bath interacts with the central particle, the excitation is not transferred to the central particle. So it is stored, it remains stored in the quantum bath. So we want to reproduce these nice features in the experiment in some sense. Okay, so how to create this initial state of the system in your quantum computing device? So initially I have shown you that we reserve this qubit for the central spin. Now I slightly change the notation. So okay, I would like to minimize the errors associated with the real device. We have chosen to associate this qubit with the central qubit with this one, and since we have only two qubits of the device of the bath, then this is okay, because you have always two C nodes here, so we associate these two qubits with the bath and this one with the central particle. So for the particular case we consider here only two particles over the bath, such a configuration is also okay. So what we do, first we create this entangled state in the system of qubits. So this is Q1 and Q2, and you see it here. And this is very similar to Bell states I have shown you before, to the creation of Bell states. First you apply Pauli X gate to the Q1, then you apply Adamard to Q2, and then you add also the gate, you probably remember, I have shown you before, the gate associated with the single qubit rotations, which is built in into the IBM quantum experience. And here you have this parameter phi, which is a tunable parameter, and you can put any phi you want here. So at the end, you get as the output this state. So it is quite easy to show that this is true. This is the example how some initial state can be created in this system. So this is the proof that this is true. So I am not going to repeat all this. You probably more or less understood all the main points. And again, I remind you that C naught is an entangling gate. It is very important in quantum, it produces quantum entanglement. And now it is crucial for quantum computation of many body systems. Okay, so I have shown you how to prepare at least some example of the initial state in a real quantum device. And we are in a good position to switch to the next step. Namely, you can simulate free evolution in a real quantum device using the evolution operator and its discretization and tartarization. Okay. There is nothing complicated here, but you have to follow. I have shown you our toy model for the single qubit. And here is the same, in some sense, for multi-qubit systems, for multi-spin systems. So the point is that you use the representation through the evolution operator, which for humans maybe is not so nice, but for quantum computer is good, and we adjust. Because sometimes when I gave this presentation at some conference in Nizhny Novgorod, by the way, last spring, one person, I was attacked by one person who told me that why you use a free evolution operator, this is stupid, you should use differential equations, you should solve differential equations. But I explained to him that this is not me, this is quantum computer, so I adjust for the quantum computer. And quantum computer cannot solve differential equation in a brute force way. So what it can do, it can make unitary rotations, and we adjust for this ability of the quantum computer. Okay, so now you have the evolution operator, which is given by this quantity, and this is nothing but the series expansion in terms of H, operator H. I remind you that H for our particularly simple model is given here. But H consists of sum of many pieces which are connected to different to different qubits and different to different representations x and y. So we have terms like this, so central x, 1x. We have central x, sigma, 2x, and we have terms of this kind, y plus y, something like that. And what we want to decompose the whole Hamiltonian or the whole the evolution operator in terms of evolution operators associated with these pieces independently. Or in this is quite generic. If we have more complicated Hamiltonian, you can have terms of this kind of individual terms or terms of like I don't know, like this three body terms. So we want to represent the total evolution operator in terms of evolution operators of individual rotations. And so I remind you that, for instance, if we take the evolution operator associated with the single spin like this, this is a rotation around z axis by here t, epsilon t. Okay? And if we have something like sigma 1 z, sigma 2 z, this is going to be rotation of this kind. So how this operator acts on different inputs. If you have, for instance, 0, 0, then it remains 0, 0, but you have here, you put here the product of sigmas corresponding to this 0. So this is 1 half and 1 half, and you have minus epsilon t by 4. But for instance, if you have here 0, 1, you get here with plus sign, okay? So it depends on the product, explicitly on the product of sigmas in these two states. So if we want to decompose the whole evolution operator in terms of these evolution operators for individual terms. And now we have to make what is known as Trotter or Trotter-Suzuki decomposition. The point is that, for instance, if you have a Hamiltonian which operator which consists of two pieces, by definition, your evolution operator is the expansion, is the series expansion in terms of the full Hamiltonian, HA plus HB. It's something like that. And if we consider evolution operators associated with any of the two pieces, these are also series expansions. Okay? Now, if we want to compare the whole evolution operator with the product of evolution operators of individual pieces, you will see that they coincide up to some correction terms. And the first correction term is proportional to t squared, t power 2. And here you have also the commutator of HA and HB. So this means that if you consider low value, small values of t, some initial moment of evolution, then you can replace this evolution operator by the product of evolution operators associated with individual pieces of your Hamiltonian. But this can be done only within some initial time interval t, which is small. You should estimate it. You should be able to estimate it. This is the error associated with the discretization of your evolution operator. And in order to make this error as much as possible, what you do a trick, a special trick. So you divide your time interval t into a sum, into small pieces, and the number of these pieces goes to infinity. So something like that, and n goes to infinity. So you then you have HA t plus HB t, and you replace it as HATN plus HBTN plus, and you take this block many times, n times actually. And for each block, you can make this Trotter decomposition in terms of a single trotter step, so you replace the evolution operator by the evolution operators corresponding to small short time intervals for evolution operators of individual HA and HB. And in this case, the error will be vanishing in the limit of a large number of trotter steps. So you have something like that. Okay? Any questions? I think this is quite basic things. Okay, so in general, the larger number of trotter steps you take, the smaller is the mathematical error associated with the discretization of the evolution operator, with the trotterization of this evolution operator. So simply speaking, if we have trotter number one, we can grasp some initial dynamics from some initial state. We increase the number of trotter steps, you can follow, you can trace the evolution of your system for a slightly longer time. And you, when you increase, you go more and more in time. And now the idea that is each block, each individual block, can be represented through quantum gates. This is the general idea of this procedure in connection to the quantum computation. Okay. Here, this is just to remind you about this toy model, single spin toy model. You have the evolution operator, which consists just from one block. This is okay. This is exact. And if you act by this evolution operator, it is represented by rotation around z axis. And if you act by this evolution operator in some initial state, you have this kind of dynamics. Now we have more complex terms, since our Hamiltonian contains spin-spin interaction in addition to three terms, spin-spin interaction of this kind. Okay, imagine for the moment that we have only z-z interaction, something like sigma 1z, sigma 2z. So how to translate it into the language of quantum gates? And the evolution operator associated with this, it is written here, okay? And its action is equivalent to the action of this circuit. And this can be proven.
So we prove that the operator in the lowest left corner is exactly...
Yes. This operator can be represented, is equivalent to this operator, written through quantum logic gates.
For small tau?
No.
For every?
For every, yeah. So let's continue. Oop. Here is the demonstration that they are identical. Imagine that your input state is a general two-qubit state. I use here spin notation, spin up and spin down, but it doesn't matter. It is like 0 and 1. You apply first CNOT. Since both qubits here were in ground states, nothing changes here. Nothing changes here because the first one was in the ground state. But here you have a change. Second one is excited. Here it becomes de-excited. Then you make a rotation. The rotation acts on one of the qubits. Here you have both qubits in the second qubit in the ground state. That's why you have here this exponent with plus sign. Here the second qubit is in excited state and you have minus sign here. Here it is again in excited state, you have minus sign here. Here it is in the ground state, you have plus sign. Then you act by a second CNOT. This two-qubit state doesn't change. This one doesn't change because the first one is in the ground state. This one does change, because this one was excited and second one becomes de-excited. And second one again, and the last one again, the second qubit changes its states. So now at the end you have something like that. Now you can compare this with this expression. When you act by the evolution operator directly on this sum, on this stuff, okay? So when you act on this, the exponent here must be proportional to the product of sigma z's in both states, and since they are both in the ground state, you have plus sign here, like here. Here you have plus and minus, product gives you minus, and here the same, minus. And here again plus, because all of them are in the excited states, and you have plus here. So results are identical. We have proven that the evolution operator took you of this kind can be represented through the quantum logic circuit for the arbitrary input state to qubit state. This is indeed identical. Now, if we have interactions of more complicated type, this was for two-body interaction, but imagine that your circuit has, for some, your Hamiltonian, for some reason, it has also something like that, three body terms. In particular, they appear when you try to simulate fermionic models. And to simulate this kind of terms in the evolution operator, you have to use circuits of this kind. So this is a direct generalization of the circuit we have seen before for two-qubit gate. And this is, by the way, there is a mistake here in the caption. Who knows where the mistake is? This is for four-body. It is the scheme is for four-body interaction, not for three-body. You see? Because there are four lines here. So this is a kind of a misprint in this paper. I have noticed it only when I prepared the presentation. So such multi-body interactions are relevant mostly for fermionic models. So we know, summarizing, we know how to discretize evolution operator and how represent it through the pieces of for individual qubits in Z basis, for two-body interaction like this, and for multi-body interactions like this. So we can do, but you probably notice that all the operators I have shown you, they are written in Z basis, so they are relevant for Z basis. And now if you want to simulate terms like XX or YY or something like that, actually it is quite simple. You have to make, maybe I will show you later, you have to make additional rotation, change of the basis before implementing all these gates. And this is quite simple. I will show you. Okay. So now we again turn to our central spin model. And first we make a one-step Trotter decomposition of the evolution operator. So you have evolution operator of this kind. And you represent it just as a product of single qubit, there are no single qubit states, single qubit terms here, only two qubit terms. So you represent as evolution operators of individual spin-spin interactions of this kind. Okay. L here is equal to zero when we consider only two spins of the bath. And of course, once you deal with the one-step Trotter decomposition, this representation, this discretization is supposed to be exact only when you have a small interval of time t. So I introduced here a dimensionless time tau, which is equal to interaction constant multiplied by t, by the actual dimensional time. So when t tau is much smaller than one, this should work. And if you go out of this interval, then you are in trouble. Discretization error becomes quite large. Okay, now you noticed already that we have in the evolution operator terms of the kind XX and YY, while I have shown for you how to work only with terms of the form ZZ. So in order to implement terms of XX, you have to change your basis. This is very similar to the change of the basis when we performed measurements in X of sigma X, you remember. So before you make these rotations, you add Adamard gates. So you change the basis, and in some sense, here you change, you should rotate back but action of the Adamard gate minus first power is more or less the same as action of H up to the some phase number, phase Winding number, which is not important when you simulate these spin models. And when here you deal with YY, you again have to change your basis. So you make change of the basis gate Y here. Don't mix it, please, with Pauli Y gate. I use the same notation, but the origin of this gate is different. So this is change of the basis gate, which is defined as the rotation around X axis by minus pi over 2. And here you rotate in the opposite direction by pi over 2. So H is actually more or less the rotation of by pi over 2 around Y axis. That's why we have H here. And as a whole, this block, this huge block, it can be used to simulate XX plus YY. So this is a quite standard block which is used in quantum computation of these spin models. So when you have terms of the kind sigma it is they are transferred to sigma x 1 1 plus sigma y oh, 1 2 1 2 and these terms they can be represented in the evolution operator by this standard block. And now we are in a position to show the whole scheme for this simple problem. I remind you that we simulate central spin problem with three particles, two particles of the bath, Q1 and Q2, and one central spin particle. So in the first stage, I have shown you how to create, this is two particle entangled state, the notation, abbreviation, for these two particles. So it is represented here as a box for simplicity. And now you have this complex interaction, which I have shown you before. So there is the interaction between Q1 and Q0, Q2 and Q0. And then at the end, we can measure whatever we want. We can measure, for instance, populations of all these three spins, but we prefer to measure only the population of the central spin because, as I showed to you, the population of this spin must be highly dependent on the character of the initial state. So when we created antisymmetric state, psi minus, the dynamics of the central spin should be suppressed. But when we created psi plus, it must be present in our system, it must be reproduced. Okay, so this is quite simple. Any questions?
Well, I've got maybe a quite general question. So you do some quantum simulations. I'm interested in what other, some, I don't know, analytical or made on common computers simulation of this model with which you can
Yeah, of course. First of all, this model is integrable. You can solve it easily on a paper. Second, there is also a kind of a quantum, not quantum, but classical simulator in IBM Quantum Experience, which is available also through the internet. So you can compare the results of the simulation using this quantum hardware with.
And so you
studied
this model just because it's simple? And
yeah,
and
this is just a demonstration to see.
It's kind of toy model,
but I am going to. To go to more sophisticated things. Okay, so this is the result of the simulation with the real quantum hardware and the comparison of the experiment with the theory. So here I plot the occupation of the central spin as a function of time, okay, time, for different kinds of initial conditions. I don't know if you can see numbers here. So phi, when phi is zero, this is the symmetric state, which should give you the dynamics for the central particle, for the population of the central particle. And when phi is pi, then this is the antisymmetric spin, and the dynamics should be suppressed. And this is experiment, and this is theory. So for each point here depicted on this plot, we used 8,000 runs executions of the algorithm. So you run your algorithm, you measure, you run, you measure, you run, you measure at 8,000 times per each point Okay.
Why there is no error bars? They are too small to be shown.
But what kind of bars? Error bars? Statistical errors? Oh, yeah, they are the small. And here is the theory. So, first of all, attention, theory is not exact. This is the approximation of the same level. So this is one step Trotter decomposition, which accumulates all the errors related to the discretization. So there is no errors of quantum hardware here, but only mathematical errors. So these results are trustable when time is small. So let's say much less than one. So they reflect the normal, the true dynamics. And then this is more or less artificial. But anyway, it is of interest to compare this real experimental data with artificial data, because errors also appear from the side of hardware and they influence these results. So you can compare and see the effect of errors of the hardware. So first of all, we see that there is, in some sense, not bad.
By the way, what's wrong with the initial conditions?
Why do you think it is wrong?
At time, at zero time.
Okay, good question. Next slide will be about this. Okay, so you see that from... Okay, so you see that in some sense there is an agreement between the theory and the experiment in the sense that qualitatively all these curves behave in the same way. And moreover, the dependence on the initial state is reproduced. So when you have phi equal to pi, you have less dynamics, and you see here and here. And when you have phi equal to zero, then you have a dynamics of the central particle. So the population starts rising. But unfortunately, or fortunately, or I don't know, there are also some discrepancies related to the errors of the real quantum hardware. And you see that all these curves, they should start from zero, but they start not from zero, but from something like 10% or 0.1. And they should rise up to almost 1, 0.8, but they rise up to 0.6. And this is the effect of gate errors, redout errors, and decoherence. But anyway, we reproduce the behavior for dark and bright states known from quantum optics on the qualitative or semi-quantitative level. We see that there is the impact of entanglement and quantum interference effects in our simulation, digital simulation. So we see the signatures that quantum interference effects can block excitation transfer to the center when you have antisymmetric state initial. In principle, this is the method to find Hamiltonian eigenstates, because if nothing changes, like here, this is suspicious. So probably this state, it might be the Hamiltonian eigenstate. Okay, now naive question, mostly from experimentalists, I'm sorry. Why is there an error already at time t equals zero? It is constantly asked by some people. So what is the answer? What do you think?
The initial state is generated with some errors.
Yeah, of course, but anyway, we deal here with the digital simulation, not the analog simulation. Time which enters here, this is not a physical time to perform the algorithm. This time enters only through rotations. So even if time goes to zero, if it is very small, and even in principle it is zero, we execute the whole algorithm. So we apply various gates, the same number of gates, but time enters only through rotation angles. This is algorithmic or digital computation or simulation, not the analog. And therefore, of course, all the errors are accumulated already for tau equals zero. You already have errors. Okay. So the time which enters our algorithm is not a physical time to perform the algorithm. It enters only through rotation angles. Basically, this is the element through which you have always this stuff. Okay, so another observation which can be deduced from this rather simple simulation is that you see here that there is, in some sense, all these curves, they are composed of the superposition of two curves. One curve is something like good curve, which should be there, and another one is some noisy background or noisy deformation, which is nearly independent on this time t. on this time tau. Okay. In some sense, if you take all these plots and if you make deformation, so first you make deformation. First you should start not from zero and not rise to up to one, and if you make deformation, you get these curves. And from one point of view, it might look as something simple and evident, but in some sense, there is a very nice feature. There are very nice features behind of this behavior, which show that the noisy background is nearly independent on time, and therefore you can illuminate it by using post-selection or some naive methods of working with the classical data you get from the quantum computer. So when you have many gates, from one point of view, this is bad because they produce large errors, but from another point of view, they lead in some sense to the randomization of wrong outputs. And that's why you have wrong background, which can be illuminated by hands, nearly flat. And on top on it, you have some signal, which can be small, but still it contains a lot of meaningful information from simulations, which you can extract from this. So this implies that sometimes errors of quantum simulation, they can help. So when you have small number of gates, they always play a destructive role. When you have large number of gates, they also play a destructive role because you have exponential decay of the success probability of your algorithm with the number of gates. But if you are somewhere in the intermediate regime, errors in some sense can help. And I will show you the reason in some schematically, some naive representation. So imagine that initial block we used in this simulation was like this, okay? And if there is no errors, if all these gates are perfect, then you should get some correct behavior of the central population of the central spin, which is schematically depicted here as a function of time. Now imagine that your two qubit gates are noisy, and in some outputs you get wrong results. For instance, imagine that this C0, it doesn't work properly, and for instance, in some realizations of your algorithm, it acts as an identity gate for simplicity, so it does nothing. Then if this particular C0 doesn't work, you get some incorrect results with this hump, for instance, shifted, okay? Then you can have the same type of error, for instance, at this guy, okay? And you have another dependence. And when you have many gates of this kind and you have events, wrong events at each site, at each C-node, then you have to sum up all these incorrect results. And they finally, if the number of these incorrect, the number of these gates is large, then all these totally incorrect results, they sum up into some flat stuff, you know. When you add many humps, you get something more or less flat. And on top of it, you have also some correct contributions coming from the events which were correct. And this is something quite non-trivial. So this means that by using, so this is my statement that errors sometimes can play a positive role. So for short circuits, they cannot play a positive role. They're always bad. For deep circuits, they are also bad. For intermediate depth circuits, they can be, in some sense, positive. And this suggests a simple idea of error mitigation, at least in this case. So instead of focusing on absolute values, you can analyze differences. So instead of considering occupation of the central spin at given time t, you can consider the occupation of this, the difference between its occupation at time t minus occupation at time zero. Okay, and if you subtract this stuff, you see that immediately you have quite good quite good agreement between the theory and the experiment, and moreover, you can go up to two Trotter steps and three Trotter steps. So we increase the number of gates and we decrease the mathematical error associated with the discretization, but still we have quite good results up to the, of course, the whole normalization, because here for theory for two Trotter steps it must grow up to 1 approximately, but here it grows only up to 0.3. So this means that 70% of our results were erroneous, but still on top of these erroneous results, we have 30% of good results, which contain valuable information, which can be extracted from these noisy calculations. And moreover, we go here up to 3 trotter steps. And now you see that, again, we analyze differences. There is not bad qualitative agreement between these two sets of curves. But already here you see that this quantity for experiment, it rises up to 0.1, but in reality it must be 1. So 90% of results were erroneous, but still we get some valuable information from this noisy stuff, you know. And you see already that these curves become quite irregular, and this means the statistical errors associated with the finite sampling, because when you make measurements, you always have an error, statistical error of the order of 1 divided by square root of n. So n originally was 8,000, but when you decrease it 10 times and you more or less redistribute, then it can become comparable with the value, the absolute value. And you see here there are some jumps already. So the statistical errors becomes noticeable. Okay, but anyway, we cannot proceed further for 4 and 5 trotter steps. But still, this is the realization of IBM. But if we go, for instance, to Google, they have much smaller CNOT error, several times smaller than IBM, and there you can probably go up to maybe 10 trotter steps using this kind of techniques.
About the previous part, how exactly do you measure this delta n? Because it seems to me that you also need to measure n at time zero.
No, but we measure always. We make measurements at different values of time, t, tau, okay? Starting from very low, from zero basically, to some finite, and then we just extract one value from another, and classically.
And each is a different run on the computer, isn't it?
Yes. No, you make many runs for each point, 8,000 runs. So for instance, for this point, you make 8,000 runs. For this point, you measure and then you extract.
So then what is the difference between the results you showed earlier, which were uglier, and this with the delta n? How is that different from just shifting?
No, but you just by hands, you extract and that's it.
But isn't that the same as just moving the graph down?
Yeah, something like that. But bringing all the drafts, because all these graphs, they are different. They start from different values, slightly different values at tau zero. So you move all of them to zero in some sense. So there is also an index here which is related to phi. Okay. It is emitted here.
But if you go back to the previous slide,
yes.
Did you also show one for the one trotter step? Because this
one.
Oh, okay. So the difference between the graph you showed first and this one is only the fact that you use 2 trotter steps rather than 1.
Yes, yes. Okay. Yeah, we increase the number of trotter steps. Yeah, please.
Is it possible to estimate how much is the signal suppressed compared to the theoretical? Suppose I don't know the maximum should be at unity, and I have 0.1, and I somehow hope to find out the correct magnitude.
Yeah, possible. You can estimate if you know the errors associated with single qubit and 2 qubit operations, then you can estimate. For instance, you make, for simplicity, you make the measurement, you make some gate, you execute some gate, and with probability p, you have wrong result. When you make n applications of this gate, the probability is like this. You see, and if you know p, you can get the estimate of this probability. So you need some analysis, of course. There is no recipe, you know, which you can use always, universally.